Good morning, Hope Church. Welcome to our Easter services. Here we are on April 12th, 2020, celebrating Easter with you. As we begin this service today, I want to thank everyone who tuned in to our live Zoom broadcast of our sunrise service today, and we appreciate all of those who joined with us during that time. As we get used to this new technology and all the different things that are happening, thank you so much for your understanding of everything we're trying to do. And for those of you that didn't get to tune in for whatever reason, we appreciate you, and we want to let you be a part of that. So we made a live recording of that service, and if you request it, we'll try to get it to you. I wanted to also just thank all the volunteers and the people who've been working, helping with the contacting people and calling people and praying with people. I just can't thank those leaders enough for all the different things that they're doing. And if you, for any reason, want to have a phone call or a prayer, or if there's something we can do to assist you in any way, please let us know, let our church staff know, email us, call us. We want to help you during this time. And we have people that are doing that. I want to thank Daniela Taylor and Christine Walker for making the safety masks for a number of people in our church. I was talking to a lady in our church, and she put her safety mask on and said, "Christine Walker made this for me." And so I want to thank Christine and others who are loving in this way. The service focus for this morning is no greater love, coming from the verse where Jesus said, "No greater love has a man than he would lay down his life for his friends." So we're working together as a community and as a country to get through this time. And it's just wonderful to be a part of our Hope Church family and know that when the chips are down and when it really matters and when things aren't going well, we have our church family to support us and to see us through. We are here today to celebrate what it means to be brothers and sisters in Christ, to celebrate the power of the resurrection. So I want to just stop this broadcast for a moment and give you an opportunity to respond wherever you may be sitting at home. As I say the ancient words, "He is risen." And the response, "He is risen indeed." So thank you for that response, wherever you were sitting in your room or wherever you were at. As we begin this service today, let's pause for a moment and recognize God's presence with us on this Easter Sunday morning. Heavenly Father, we're so thankful for the gift that you gave us when Jesus came to this earth. You came to love. You came to heal. You came to forgive. And Lord, we celebrate all of those things. But today we celebrate the power of the resurrection. And that no matter what's happening today, we can face tomorrow because we know that you live. We can face tomorrow without fear. We can face tomorrow with hope and confidence because we know that this life here on earth is only the beginning and not the end. So we ask your blessing over this service today. For each person who may be tuning into our broadcast today, I just pray that you would be with us as we celebrate what it means to know that we can face tomorrow because you live. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Thanks, Pastor Matt. Hey, everyone. Happy Resurrection Day. We're so excited and ready to praise our Lord. He is indeed alive. And we are just so excited to celebrate Resurrection Day with you today. And we just cannot wait to enter into a time of worship with you. Before we do go into worship today, we just wanted to let you know that we are doing a new song today. And so we're going to have the words, the lyrics to this worship song for you, as well as the other songs as well, just so you can sing along with us. We figured it'd be easier for you to worship if you knew the words. And we are just encouraging you, if you can, and if you'd like to, sing along with us as we sing our praises to our Heavenly Father. So with that said, let's enter into a time of worship. Heavenly Father, we just thank you so much for the work that you did on that cross, Father. We're so excited that you are our God, that you indeed have risen, Father. And we are just here to celebrate the glory that you have brought to yourself through your Son, Jesus Christ. So, Father, we just ask that you would hear our praise, Lord, that it would just be music to your ears, Lord. And we just cannot wait to hear the message today about the resurrection of our Savior, Jesus Christ. So, Lord, hear us as we lift up your holy name. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Sin through sacrifice to conquer every sting of death. Sing, sing, alleluia. For joy awakes as dawning light when Christ's disciples lift their eyes. Alive he stands, their friend and king. Christ, he is risen. Christ is risen, he is risen indeed. Oh, sing alleluia. Join the chorus, sing with the redeemed. Christ is risen, he is risen indeed. Where doubt and darkness once had been, they saw him and their hearts believed. But blessed are those who have not seen, yet sing alleluia. Once bound by fear, now bold in faith, they preach the truth and power of grace. And pouring out their lives, they gained life, life everlasting. Christ, he is risen, he is risen indeed. Oh, sing hallelujah. Join the chorus, sing with the redeemed. Christ is risen, he is risen indeed. That raised him from the grave now works in us to powerfully save. He frees our hearts to live his grace. Go tell of his goodness. Christ, he is risen, he is risen indeed. Oh, sing hallelujah. Sing with the redeemed. Christ is risen, he is risen indeed. He's alive, he is alive. Heaven's gates are open wide. He's alive, he is alive. Now in heaven glorified. He's alive, he is alive.
Resurrection power living on the is good, my unending need.
Lord, you are our rock, Father. You are indeed our Redeemer. And we thank you that you left your throne, Father, for us. We just cannot imagine, and we can't wait to see all the wonders that heaven has for us. But we just thank you that you left all that for us. Thank you, Lord. That's all we can say is just thank you. We are in awe of your grace, your mercy, and of your love. So, Lord, open our ears, open our hearts to hear and feel the message that you have for us today. And we ask this in Jesus' most wonderful name. Amen. Pastor Matt, go ahead and take us away. We're excited to hear the message today.
Every year, a special Easter offering for missions and missionaries around the world. And we pray for those who are in places around the world where they are on the front lines, so to speak, in countries like Botswana, Rwanda, Ethiopia, places around the Horn of Africa where they go into that we can't even talk about the fact that they're going into. We call them creative access areas. Our church and the church around the world in 120-plus world areas, world countries, and so all over the world today, the gifts that you give to support the church are not just staying here, but going other places as well, and ministering not only around the world, but here in our own country, and even here in our own community. So thank you for your support of Hope Church and the ministries of Hope Church on this Easter Sunday, as we raise a special offering for missions. And if you would like to give to missions around the world, just online when you put that in your memo, or if you write a check and send it to the church, just put that in the memo for missions, and we'll make sure that it gets to the proper place. We thank you so much for your continued giving, and you can do that online through the website, and you can continue to mail in your gifts. Thank you so much for your continued faithfulness in this very important area. And I want to report to you as our church family this morning that God is meeting our needs and he's seeing us through this time thanks to your generosity and your continued faithfulness. And so as we take up the offering today and we remember the stewardship of what God has blessed us with, let's just pause for a moment and thank God for his blessings to us. Heavenly Father, we ask right now that as people are watching this broadcast, that you will continue to bless them through this difficult time. We know that some people, maybe watching right now, have lost their job. And that's a very difficult thing as we wrestle with the economic fallout of this response to this virus. So, Lord, be with those families that are struggling financially. We lift them up to you. And Lord, we thank you for those that are blessed that still have their jobs, and we ask for your continued blessing over their lives as they continue to be faithful stewards of what you've blessed them with. But Lord, as important as we are and as important as all the things that we're going through are, Lord, right now we lift up our missionaries around the world, those who are in countries that will be impossible for us to put a finger on if we had to walk up to a map to put a finger on. But Lord, you know where they're at right now. Keep them safe from harm and danger. Watch over them as they faithfully spread the message of your love to the people of whatever the country is that they may be in. All over the world right now, we pray a blessing over them. Be with our church and be with those that are ministering in the life of our church here in our own country and right here in our own community, Lord. Thank you for the blessing that it is on this Easter Sunday morning to be a part of your church family. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. There's a very important scripture in the Bible where Jesus is talking to his disciples. And he's talking to them about what love looks like. And he says, if you want to see what love looks like, it looks like what happens when someone else lays down their life for their friends. And that's, he said, what love is supposed to look like. There's been many stories throughout time about men in combat who have sacrificed their lives so that others could live. And on this day, we celebrate the fact that Jesus gave himself so that we could know what God's love looks like. And that not only did he give himself on the cross for us, but today, if you'll notice, there is a white drape over the cross behind me. And that white drape signifies the fact that when the ladies came to that tomb, they found it empty. And they found his grave clothes, his white grave clothes, neatly folded there. And he had risen. So this song we sing together as a church is called No Greater Love Has Ever Been or Ever Will Be Known That a Man Would Die, Lay Down His Life, and Give It for His Friends. And so as we sing that together, let's just remember how much we are loved by God. That is the title of our service today, No Greater Love, as we think of the cross and we think of what was happening on this Easter Sunday, all the things going on, all the things happening in the world where the disciples were living. The text that we have for this morning is an important text because it brings us back to an understanding of what was going on in the world and during that time. And the whole point of the reason why Jesus came and what was happening was so that people who had been in the darkness, people who had not known God's love, people who had not known God's light, could find his love and his light once again. And I don't think there was ever a darker time in the life of the people of God than during this time. They were under enemy occupation. The Romans had completely conquered most of the known world, including Jerusalem. And Jerusalem suffered under a terrible king and dictator by the name of Herod. They hadn't known what it was like to live in freedom as the people of God for many years. And Jesus tells them something very interesting in John chapter 8. And he says this, "I tell you the truth, everyone who sins is a slave to sin. Now a slave has no permanent place in the family, but a son belongs to it forever. So if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed." During this time, as we're here in 2020, there is a lot of fear. A lot of fear going on with the things that are happening in our world. People are afraid because of this virus. They're afraid they might get sick. And we've been doing our best to help each other out as a society and as a community by staying at a distance from each other. A new word is in our vocabulary now called social distancing. And we're afraid to make each other sick, and so we're trying to love each other by staying away from each other. And so we're doing that. And we're trying very hard to not make each other afraid of each other. I went through a local establishment, I won't give the name, a drive-thru, and the young people that were out there looked like they stepped off of some kind of a really bad sci-fi Star Wars movie. They had these black masks on. Oh, that's the other thing. If anybody coughs or sneezes, everybody runs. It's like, what? Stop that. It's like before, 2 months ago, you could cough and nobody would like put you in the corner, but now, better watch yourself. They looked like they stepped off this bad sci-fi movie, these black masks and all this neoprene on, and they were, taking my order, talking through the mask, Wow, this is our reality. You know, 2 months ago, you'd looked at them and thought, what is wrong with these people? But here we are. And the fear that's coming out of this, because people's value of their lives. And that's an important value, and I don't want to minimize that, and I don't want to say that what we're doing isn't important, because it is. But Jesus came so that we could be free. And there's four really important things that Jesus came and that the love of Jesus showed us that we could be free from. And the first thing is that he gave us freedom from being slaves to sin. Those of you who have struggled with an addiction, those of you who have struggled with a habit, a bad habit of some kind, those of you that may have been walking for a long time in the wrong direction, know better than anybody else what I'm talking about when I say sin will enslave you. It will make you its master. And everybody's going to choose what they're going to serve. And as Joshua said at the beginning of his great book and his great story, choose you this day whom you will serve. As for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. Jesus came, and his name, Yeshua, is the modern, in his time, the modern abbreviation for Joshua. Those connections there are so important as we think about the freedom that God sent Jesus to deliver us from, the freedom from our evil habits, from our evil desires, from our evil addictions, all the things that would drag us down and bring us into chaos and darkness. Jesus came as the Son that he talked himself about there in John chapter 8. A son belongs to a house forever. A slave can never be a part of the house. Jesus came so we would not have to be slaves, but we could belong. And he came so that we could have freedom from sin. Freedom from fear with all of its torments. Freedom from the love and the glitter of gold. All those things. Freedom in Christ, my blessed Redeemer. And all these things that Jesus came to bring us freedom from, sin is right there at the top of the list. Because we don't have to live in bondage any longer. we can live in the freedom of knowing that we're forgiven and knowing that we're loved by God through Jesus. And then Jesus didn't just come for us to have freedom from sin, as important as that is, and as wonderful as that is. Jesus also came so that we could be free from punishment. You see, when we do things that are wrong, we deserve to be punished. When we do things we shouldn't do, there's going to be a consequence. But the amazing thing about God's love for us is that He has chosen not just to deliver us from the bondage of living in sin, but from the consequences of that sin itself. So many times it's difficult for us to learn that as God forgives us, we can also forgive ourselves, because we're not going to receive any punishment for the things we've done that are wrong if we just simply ask Jesus to forgive us. And when we do that, the punishment of all those things that we deserve is completely negated. We are not going to be punished for the things we've done that are wrong if we just ask Jesus to forgive us. You see, I believe that the only way that you're ever going to be punished for the things you've done that are wrong is if you just tell God, no, I don't want to go to heaven with you. You're going to have to look God right in the eye and say, God, I'm not going to heaven with you, and you can't force me. I believe that God wants everyone to come to Himself, everyone to come and be counted as part of the family. You're His child. You are loved by Him. And so God doesn't want to punish you. He wants to embrace you. He wants to give you a big hug and say, welcome to heaven. The only way you don't get to heaven is because God is not going to force you to go there. And Jesus came so that we could be delivered from the punishment that we all deserve. And that punishment is not going to matter because we've been forgiven when we ask Jesus to forgive us. He came so that we could have forgiveness from the bondage of sin. He came so that we could have forgiveness from any kind of punishment. And then He came so that we could have victory even in death itself. And you know, it's very difficult for us to find any type of joy in death. It's one of the most difficult things that any of us will ever face. And we can't face it ultimately with anyone else. We have to face it by ourselves. And Jesus faced His own death. And because of God's love for us, He didn't just leave Jesus in the grave. Jesus was destined from the dawn of time to be raised again in newness of life. Sin, hell, death. We have freedom because we know that death is not the end. Even in our hour of death, even in our own moments where we make the transition from this world to the next, we can have confidence that the love that Jesus has for us is not going to leave us even in the times when we're facing the worst of circumstances. We can live with joy because of what God is doing. There's a story that circulated through Chicken Soup for the Soul and all these other books and all these other things. It's the story about two siblings who really hate each other. A brother and a sister can't stand each other. I think the first time it was ever in a movie was in Little Annie Rooney in 1925, where she had an older brother who was kind of an outlaw, and he got shot. And so the doctors said they needed a blood transfusion, and so she came in and laid down on the table and was willing to give her blood for her brother. And as the blood flowed out of her veins into her brother, she looked over the doctor and weakly said, "Is it going to hurt when I die?" What she didn't realize is that the doctor wasn't asking for all of her blood, but just for enough to help her brother. But she had been willing and not understanding that she wasn't going to have to give all her blood, but she was willing to give everything for the brother that she didn't even really get along with. Now, that story's been going around for 90 years in all the different forums, and if you can look online, you'll see that story in all its different ways and forms. But somewhere along back through the centuries of time, there's been this story that's been told over and over and over again about two siblings and one brother or one sister being willing to give everything so that the other could live. That's really the heart of the story of Jesus. That Jesus was willing to give everything, willing to give his life to his last, literally, to his last drop of blood so that we could live. You see, the story of Jesus is about life, a life free to be the best we can be, a life that gives us victory in the things that we do. We don't have to live in chaos. We can live in righteousness and in blessing. We don't have to live with the fear of being punished at some point in the future by a vengeful God who wants to take us out and punish us for eternity. And we don't have to live in fear of death because Jesus conquered death for us. Helped us to understand and to know that death is not the end. Death is just the beginning. And the final part of what Jesus came so that we wouldn't have to be afraid of anymore was the grave itself. Everyone who lives and dies is going to have an end, some place where our final remains end up. And the grave is not the end, because our faith informs us that just as Jesus was raised from the dead, so too we are going to be raised from the dead. What an amazing part of the story to think about. You know, faith is such an important thing. And people who don't know the story that we tell sometimes look at our story and say, "You really believe that? You really believe this story? This is really how you organize your life and live your life? You believe the ancient words of a 2,000-year-old book that tells you that a man came and lived and died and rose again, and he was the Son of God, and he came to show us God's love, and that there's an eternity out there that we're going to live together with him, and this is the story, this is the truth of who we are, look at all we know, all the science and all the different things that we know, and all the different things that we've experienced, all the theories and all of the knowledge that we have, and yet this is still the faith that you believe and cling to? It absolutely is. Because look at what's happened in our world today. Right now, as we're here in 2020, everyone in the so-called advanced world, all the first world countries, are completely paralyzed by a small, tiny virus that you can hardly see. Even with a telescope, it's so small, but yet this little tiny virus has gone all around the world in spite of all of our knowledge and all of our technology and all the things that we're able to do, all the things that we're able to accomplish. It's completely shut us down. And the reason why we're distancing and the reason why we're doing all these things is to try to help each other stay alive. And it's important. Don't get me wrong. I'm not saying that that's not an important thing. But listen, the faith that tells us the story of Jesus is true is the same faith that tells us that we don't live in fear of sin. We don't live in fear of hell. We don't live in fear of death. We don't live in fear of the grave, because God's love is what's going to make the difference in all of those things. It's His love that's going to see us through. It's His love that's going to make us whole again. The cross is sometimes no more than a piece of jewelry now. It doesn't mean anything to the culture the way it used to. All the symbols of religiosity are just that. They're just symbols. But at the heart of who we are, at the essence of who we are as people, God is calling us, as He's called us now for centuries, to listen to the words of Jesus when he tells us, if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed. You know, we've talked about the truth setting us free and you'll be free indeed, but that's not what this says. This says, if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed. And on this Easter Sunday morning, I want to give us all the opportunity to be free. If you're tuning into this broadcast and you don't know Jesus, maybe you've walked away and maybe through all of the things that have been going on, you felt an emptiness in your spirit. You felt fear. You've been afraid. And you need God's help to help you not be afraid. I want to pray with you this morning and ask God to help you so that you don't have to live in fear, but you can live in freedom. You don't have to live thinking and wondering about how you're going to get through this virus and all the things. You just know God's in control and he's the one that's going to be there for us through all of these things that we are afraid of. And by the way, these four things are the things that all of us fear and that all of us can have the freedom to not have to be afraid anymore. So let's just pause for a moment here and let's just pray on this Easter Sunday that God will help us through the fears that we may be going through. And as you're praying right there in your home, maybe you're good. Maybe you're free. You say, Pastor Matt, I am so thankful that I am free. I am free from the fear of tomorrow. I'm free from the guilt of my past. I've traded my shackles for a glorious song. I'm free. Maybe that's you, but maybe there's somebody in your family or in your community or your neighbor who you know is bound up in fear. All they're talking about is what's happening with the economy and what's happening with the health of people, and they're just living in that fear. Pray for them as we pray together today that God will lift them up and help them through this time to have that confidence that God is going to see us through. And if you're struggling with a financial situation, you don't know how you're going to pay your bills, I want you to know as a community and as a country, we're working together to try to help us get through this. And we will get through this. So let's just pray together and ask God's help. Heavenly Father, thank you for this opportunity to know that as we're sitting here right now and as we're standing here right now, wherever we may be, you know what's happening. And so God, thank you. Thank you for helping us right now in the way that only you can come into our hearts and help us to be free from any fear we would have. Give us that confidence that comes from knowing your love casts out fear. And that there's no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. We don't have to be afraid of sin, of punishment, of death, of the grave. Even though in our own hearts and minds it's a natural thing to fear all of those things. Help us, Lord, to live towards the freedom that you provide for us. The freedom you gave us when you lived, when you loved, when you died, and when you rose again. Thank you for this wonderful story that we have to tell about your love for us. So God, I just pray that you'd be with us, watch over us, for our neighbors, for our friends, for those around us who may be living in fear. God, help us to be that quiet confidence and that quiet sense of joy even through these difficult times. And Lord, if there's someone here right now who's struggling with that fear, I pray that you would send the angels of heaven right now to surround them, to help them, to encourage them, and to lift them up, to replace that fear with faith, a greater faith than they've ever had before, so that we would grow stronger and more mature in our relationship with you and with each other. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless each one of you. Over the next few weeks, we're going to be having some people come in and help us out with the preaching here at Hope Church. And then when I come back, I will be starting a new sermon series on the enduring promises of God. So the enduring promises of God and what that looks like is what we're going to be speaking about over the next several months. And I want to thank every person who's helping out with staying in contact and praying and encouraging others. God's helping us as a church to continue, not just to survive, but to thrive through these times. And as we think about all the things that God has blessed us with, figure out a way this Easter to bless someone else and to help someone else on this wonderful Easter Sunday. God bless you. Have a wonderful week. I was buried.